Welcome to the Susquehanna Valley Baptist Pulpit, preaching a life worth living, abundant life in Christ. And now the message.
Note here in Ephesians chapter 5, we're continuing our study. I'm skipping over a phrase this morning, and I want to be honest textually with you, but I'm skipping over the phrase, but be filled with the Spirit. We are going to revisit that. But I want to press forward for the next week or two on two more themes, and then circle back before we attack the balance of the chapter. In fact, if you write in your Bible, circle that phrase, but be filled with the Spirit. Circle it. It would do you well that what we speak of today and next week, coming weeks ahead out of Ephesians chapter 5, are not possible if you do not yield to the Spirit of God in your life. But moving this morning forward, we're looking at the actions of the Spirit-filled life. Specifically, contextually, about adoring the worthy one. And note our text in verse number 19, speaking to yourselves in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. What a wonderful imperative, speaking to yourselves, and then later singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. We asked ourselves a couple of weeks ago a question, and the question was this: what does God want from me? That's an important thing. It's a really important topic to consider, because if we cannot affirmatively answer this, and more importantly than just affirming it, if we cannot correctly answer it, then we're kind of flapping, as it were, in the breeze, unsure if the decisions we make in life and what we engage in, our likes and dislikes, please God or don't please God. What is it that God wants from me? Now, one of those that we highlighted answer is found in verse number 14. The first thing that God wants from you is He wants you to be His child. You are not God's child simply because you are a human. You are not God's child simply because your neighbor may deem you to be a good person. You are not God's child because of your intellect. You are not God's child because of your finances. And you are not God's child even though you may have experienced and likely have the goodness of God laid unto you. Every individual experiences certain good gifts from God. Well, last evening, the people in our community experienced God's good blessing because it rained. What a glorious rain it was. And then you could look out. As I did, I went onto my porch and I looked to the eastward sky, and lo and behold, there was a rainbow. And I regretted that I have some colorblind tendencies with my eyes. And my daughter told me that, Dad, in fact, there were two rainbows in that sky, one of which you did not notice. Another child came up to me and said, Dad, that is such a beautiful rainbow. You can even see the fringe purples. Dad, can you see it? And I said, no, I cannot see it. They blend together. But there was a rainbow there. And any individual that was in my locale yesterday around 6:30 experienced God's blessing as rain descended. And what a wonderful rain it was. Every individual that was present that could lift their eyes and see saw the beautiful rainbow that was present. Everyone has a certain level of blessing that God has given to them. Just because you've been blessed of God, physically, financially, whatever that may be, is not the same thing as being a child of God. The Scripture tells us in Romans 10 that faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, but not all have obeyed this gospel. The fact of the matter is, to become a child of God, you must bow the knee to the Almighty God. You must confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and must believe in your heart that God has raised Him from the dead. Then thou shalt be saved. This is an important aspect. This is what every individual has. This is the beginning element to accomplishing the will of God. This is what God wants from you. Yes, it is true that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have eternal life. But just because God loves you, and just because you've experienced blessing, and just because your neighbor deems you a good person, is not the same thing as saying that you're a child of God and therefore an heir of Christ Jesus. Churches today are full of individuals that are misconveying and misunderstanding those facts of truths of Scriptures. They think because they go to church that in fact they're a child of God. That is not true. In the day of judgment, there will be many that say, Lord, Lord, and He says, I will say unto them, depart from me, I never knew you. Church houses are full of individuals that have a knowledge of God, but they have no redemptive power upon their life. What do you mean? They have never confessed their sins before Him. They have never received, if you will, the forgiveness of the Almighty God. They have never embraced Jesus Christ as their Savior. Churches are full, and seminaries that are supposed to produce the preachers that will go forth and proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, are full of individuals that have wonderful grasp of so many wonderful talents and abilities, but know not of the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. There'll be a number of illiterate people in the presence of the Almighty God. There'll be many a poor people in the presence of the Almighty God because of their faith in Him. But hell will be full of some of the greatest academics whose wisdom of this world prevented them from receiving the truths of the gospel of Jesus Christ. What is it God wants from you? God wants you to know that you are saved. He wants you to understand salvation. He wants you to understand that He loves you. He wants you to understand His characteristics. The chiefest of those is His holiness. And if you do not at this once receive Him as your Savior, there'll come a day that He will be your judge. Just as He'll save the greatest sinner, just as He'll reach into the deepest gutter and save anybody by faith that would receive Him, in that day even the greatest of nobility will stand trembling before His presence. And in this age, in this time in which we live, we have a pause. Man can look to God and receive Him by faith, or man can ignore God and reject Him through rebellion. This is man's choice. But God will have the final say on the matter. I'm stricken with great fear in my heart when I think of Revelation chapter 20. John said, "And I saw a great white throne judgment, and the heavens and earth fled away." He's talking about all that you knew was not there. Before this great white throne and Him that sat upon this throne, it goes on to say something. "I saw the dead, great and small." He's not talking about your stature, though that would be applicably true. He's talking about your prestige of life. Rich and poor, they stood, and the books were open. And whoever's name was not found in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. That's an awful, awful conclusion. As many of individuals with grand talents that have rejected Christ. And one day the book of life that records the name of every individual present that has known Him as Savior will be opened. My name's there. Many of your names are there. But there's enough space in that book for anyone ever born to humanity. Why? Because God is not willing that any should perish, but that all come to repentance. But if you'll not choose to bow the knee in this life, note this, you will bow the knee by force in the life that is to yet come. But that judgment is an eternal judgment. What does God want from you? He wants you to receive the light of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. And then we move from thence. What does God want from you? He wants you to embrace wisdom. He says in verse 15, "Walk circumspectly, not as fools, but wise." He wants you to know wisdom. And we could cross-reference that with Proverbs chapter 8. Wisdom is the principal thing. She's exalted. She is lifted up. She has builded her house. All the manifestation of wisdom. God wants you to know Him. He wants you to know the truths of the Word of God. God wants you to know wisdom. Thirdly, we look down in verse number 18, and we'll revisit this one. He wants you to be yielded to His Spirit. That's what that word filled means, complied to, yielded to His Spirit. But what else is it that God wants me to do? Well, once you're yielded to His Spirit, the balance of these are possible. But in verse number 19, He wants you to be singing. We could look ahead to next week, perhaps. He wants you to give thanks. We could look ahead to verse 21. He wants you to be submissive. We could look ahead the end of the chapter, the beginning of the next chapter, He wants you to have the right relationships. You look ahead in chapter 6, He wants you to have the right preparation of heart and mind. We look ahead to the balance of the chapter, He wants you to have the right intercession. Praying always. That's really the theme. This is the practical outflowing of all of the preceding doctrinal truth. God is not unclear on what he wants for you and I. He wants, as we'll look at this morning, the mark of that spirit-filled Christian life. He wants you to be a singing saint. Note there, speaking to yourselves in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. These are the actions, one of the actions of a spirit-filled life. Now let me ask you a question. How long has singing been around? At the onset, I clued you in on some of this. Look over, if you will. Go to Genesis. How long has singing and music, which is associated even in this passage, how long has it been around? Well, that's a good question. And if you were to do a topical singing, and I'm going to do a little bit of one with you this morning on music and singing, you'll note that it's been around almost as long as humanity's been around. Look, if you will, you're in Genesis. Notice chapter 4. Now, just for context's sake, this is the line of Cain. This is some of the descendants of Cain. Cain's descendants are not in existence now. There's this foolish teaching that came out many years ago that the mark of Cain was that God made him a black man. That's foolishness. Said why? Because all of Cain's descendants have been cut off. Why? They all died in the flood. Why? Because there was a legacy of constantly rejecting the Almighty God. That does not mean they weren't intelligent people. I said at the onset, there'll be many of an intelligent, talented person that will reject God. Notice here, Cain in verse 17 knew his wife. She conceived and bare Enoch. Notice what Enoch, not the same that we'll find later in chapter 5. Different Enoch. Bear him Enoch. And notice what this fellow did. He builded a city and called the name of the city after the name of his son, Enoch. Let me ask you a question. Here's Cain. He's building the city. Is it wrong to live in cities? I didn't ask you if you prefer to live in cities. Is it wrong to live in a city? No, it's not wrong to live in a city. I heard someone the other day. I was out and about and just standing in line, and two or three people in front of me, they knew each other from high school. They all used to live not far from where I live now. And they hadn't seen each other in years, and you know how that, they weren't really friends, but when they were younger, they all run around the same neighborhood. And so they kept name dropping, you know where this person is? And what had happened is these little children had grown up, went out different ways in life, and now they had just bumped into each other at this shopping establishment, and they had all relocated. One of them had never left the area. One had come back 10 years ago, and one just got back last month. And they were just catching up. And one lady said, you know what I love about this area? And I, since I was listening to the conversation, probably could have chimed in. I almost chimed in. She said, you know what I love about this area? How much is available to me within 1 mile of my house? And I was like, I hear you, sister. I like it. Fuel efficiency in any car. Anyway, here's a fellow building a city. Are cities wrong inherently? No. Does a lot of crime happen with cities? Yes. All right, let's move on. Verse 18, and Enoch was born unto Irad. His name means the fugitive. And Irad begat Mahujael. And Mahujael begat Methusalel. Mahujael means smitten of God. And Methusael means man of many gods. Methusael begat Lamech. And Lamech took unto him two wives. The first time plural marriages are mentioned in Scripture, it's the line of Cain that did it. Lamech took to him two wives. The name of the one was Adah, and the name of the other Zillah. And Adah bare Jubal. And he was the father of such that dwell in tents and such that have cattle. And I'm going to ask you a question. It's the first time you've got a cattleman here. It's the first time you've got, are cattle wrong? Is it okay to raise cattle? Yeah. Can a lot of sin happen with cattle? Yes. Yeah, sure. Sure. You get all manner of sin with cattle. You think of the old cattle boy out in the Wild West and all the sin and illicit living that is often associated with that lifestyle. But are cows inherently wrong? Is it wrong to raise them or eat them? Some of you right now are thinking, I hope not, it's what's for lunch. All right. And his brother's name was Jabel. And he was the father of all that handle the harp and the organ. The chronology of scriptures is the first time you have any reference to musical instruments whatsoever. Let me ask you a question. Is it wrong to be able to play a harp or an organ? No. Is it wrong to play any musical instrument? Can much sin be created with a musical instrument? Now you see why I asked all those questions. The sin was not committed with cattle rearing. It wasn't committed with the city. But one of this descendants, in fact, if you look in verse 22, you got Tubal Cain, and he's one of the first metal fashioners that you're going to meet. He is an artificer, instructor, master of, if you will, an instructor of every artificer in brass and iron. Is it wrong to be able to work with metal? Well, I hope not. None of you got here in cardboard cars. I show you these things because I want you to know that that line of Cain, a couple of things. Number one, was an intelligent line. Number two, they were an influential line. Number three, that there's always been a parallel in life of that which is good and that which is of evil. Notice second place, if you will, in Ezekiel chapter 28. This is really chronologically, really Genesis is the first book in the canon of scriptures, but chronologically certain passages of scriptures happened before that occurred. And one of those is Ezekiel chapter 28. Ezekiel chapter 28 is the twin passage to Isaiah chapter 14 that deals with part of the sin and the casting down judgment of an angel of the Almighty God named Lucifer that we refer to as his name Satan, which means deceiver. Notice, if you will, this dual prophecy also referencing the king of Tyrus. But notice in verse 13, dual prophecies are not rare in scriptures. They occur very often. In addition to Tyrus, this is also the prophecy of Lucifer. Notice in verse 13, thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God, every precious stone was thy covering, the sardis and topaz and diamond and beryl and onyx and jasper and sapphire, the emerald, the carbuncle and gold. Then he continues, the workmanship of thy tabrets and of thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou wast created. What are you referencing, preacher? This anointed cherub, Lucifer, he was created with the ability to handle the pipes and the tabrets particularly. What are you saying? I'm saying that one of the greatest nemesis to a believer in this life is the evil one who had as his great installed attribute his talents. He was created to be musical. Now, was he the chief musician of heaven? The scripture does not say. But he was created to be musical. And shortly after the removal from the Garden of Eden, one of the first things that humanity did is they learned how to play musical instruments. Now back to Ephesians chapter 5. Is all music sin? No. Can there be a lot of sin with music? Yes. Are believers supposed to be completely insulated from any kind of music whatsoever? No. God wants you to sing praises unto his name. In fact, songs have been important to the hearts and mind of believers throughout the scriptures. I'll read you a couple of passages. You can copy these down and do your own topical study on this. For instance, the first time I believe that you'll find the word sang in scripture is actually in Exodus chapter 15, where Moses and Israel sang praises to God. And I believe the context of that was the destruction of Pharaoh. They're rejoicing over God's victory over their enemy. In Deuteronomy chapter 32, you have a whole chapter there themed the Song of Moses. In Judges chapter 5, you've got the Song of Deborah and Barak. In 2 Samuel chapter 22, you got the Song of David. You have a whole multi-chapter book called the Canticles, referred to as the Song of Solomon. Jeremiah penned, by inspiration, the Lamentations, which is, in a sense, a funeral song. In the Psalms itself, you have Psalms of Asa. Perhaps you'll look in the 83rd Psalm. You got the Psalms of David, which were replete. Some are to the chief musicians. Some are to the songs of Korah. Some are to the Levites. Different groups of people singing psalms recorded for us in scriptures. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, those in the music ministry get to hear about these folks at least once or twice a year. But you have the sons of Kohath, which were Levitical descendants who handled and dealt and oversaw and involved themselves with the singing of the Word of God in the temple of Solomon's time. Isaiah sang. You'll find of this in chapter 12 and later in chapter 42 and verse 10. In fact, when Solomon goes to dedicate the temple in 1 Chronicles chapter 23, you'll find that he had over 4,000 dedicated singers in the temple on that day. And often with them is mentioned the phrase that they were cunning or skilled. Music is mentioned often in scriptures. In fact, a reference to music is found more than 1,200 times in scriptures. And in the Old Testament music was used for all sorts of purposes. For instance, in Numbers chapter 21 and verse 17 and 18, you have work songs. Whistle while you work, da 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 da. No, that wasn't one of them. But you have songs that they sang while they labored. In Numbers chapter 21 and 27 through 30, you have war songs. Songs that they sang when they were about to go to battle. Psalm 45 and the Canticles of Solomon, you have love songs. In fact, the Song of Solomon, he talks about, I'll sing unto my beloved. In Job chapter 21, you have entertaining songs. Job talks about he would be the theme of their songs that they sang. He was not talking in a Christian sense. He was talking about those that in the area had heard of him. They would just incorporate his life story into like a ballad. A ballad. In Job 30, in the book of Lamentations, you have mourning songs. Mourning songs. And of course, here in Ephesians, you have worship songs. All manner of singing in the scriptures. In fact, you've got the singing of the Israelites we mentioned in Exodus chapter 15. Levitical singers like Samuel's son Heman in 1 Chronicles chapter 9 and verse 33. Many of them, in fact, the majority of them, had musical accompaniment. In Matthew chapter 26, you've got disciples singing. For after they had received the Last Supper with the Lord, what did they do before they went out? They sang a hymn. You've got the singing of the apostles. Old Silas and the apostle Paul were in the Philippian jail. And what were they doing at midnight? Singing praises unto God. In Colossians chapter 3, which is the sister verse to Ephesians chapter 5, you got singing in the church, and you'll have singing in the future. For in Revelation chapter 5 and Revelation chapter 14, you've got singing around the throne of God. And in Revelation chapter 15, and this is quite interesting, you'll find in that day to come, all of heaven is singing the song of Moses and the song of the Lamb. Is it possible to consider that in the end times, there'll be a day with the throne of God and all the saints and their glorified bodies around the presence of the Almighty God that they'll be singing the song of Moses that's found for us in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 32? He says they'll sing the song of Moses and the song of the Lamb. Singing to God and about God is a chief responsibility of His children. So with that being said, that would conclude the message, right? There's no paradigms, there's no principles, there's no caveats. Just go out and do whatever you want, and as long as your heart is noble, and as long as you mean it for God, that's good enough. No. There are many caveats. I'm going to give you four this morning. We're going to look right here in verse number 19 as our text. Though we're going to make many references to principles and precepts, and if time remains, I have 14 principles that I'll share to you. This is not what our text is this morning, but I do have 14 principles that ought to serve as parameters for the music that a child of God listens to. Does God change? No. If God cared with great specificity, the Old Testament offerings, don't you think He cares about the offerings you give Him? We've changed. Our music's changed. My friend, there's things that are considered music today that 50 years ago would have been laughed out of this world. Why, in the 50s, when Elvis Presley showed on TV and began to gyrate his hips, they blocked it from broadcast TV. Said it wasn't sustainable. And now, we look back on that all those many years ago, it's hard to believe, 70 years ago. We'd look back on that historical thing and say, well, that really wasn't that bad. Why? Compared to some of the modern music we've got today, full of nudity, danger, death, drugs, and every evil thing, 1950 version of Elvis Presley seems rather moot, to be sure. Or rather muted, to be sure. Humanity changes. Does God change? No. It is indicative, it's an imperative that you and I be involved in singing and music and speaking to ourselves in psalms and hymns. But what are the paradigms? What are the boundaries? I want you to notice, number one, the great caution. Let me give you three cautions that we find here in the Scriptures. I think the first of these would be that item I had you circle at the onset, but be filled with the Spirit. Talent is not the filling of the Spirit. Talent is not the filling of the Spirit. One more time for emphasis' sake. Talent is not the same thing as the filling of the Spirit. Oh, surely to be said, it is unmatched to have a child of God that is Spirit-filled, Spirit-submitted with great talent. That's unmatched. But what does God value most? God's not impressed with your talent. He gave it to you. And certainly He gave someone besides you greater talent than you've got. So if you get pretty full on the talents that you've got, look in the mirror and say, God gave it to me. And there's somebody He gave more than He gave to me. Your talent is not the same thing. I would note in churches today, most churches today, that's the main thing. Talent drives the boat. That doesn't impress God. God is greatly glorified when His children bow the knee in humble submission to Him. Being Spirit-filled, being submissive and sensitive to the things of God is the paramount portion of worshiping God. Listen, friend, we all know this to be true. Was God greatly impressed with the wealth that all of those individuals on that certain day dropped in? The great wealth in the parable of the lady with the one mite? What was the lesson there? You have a lady in humble compliance, giving out of her deep poverty. You have someone here that perhaps from talent, perhaps from inheritance, is dropping in of their abundance. Which one was the beneficial one? Was talent the praise? No. And my friend, it's important for you and I to note this. God is desirous of our submission and yieldingness to Him. Yes, if that can be coupled with our talent, how glorious and edifying that truly will be to so many people. But if all of we've got is talent and we have no Spirit submission, then we're nothing but a bunch of noise at all in His ears. For truly, is that not what is said in 1 Corinthians? If I have not charity, I'm but tinkling brass and sounding cymbals. Caution, the necessity of being yielded to the Spirit of God. Number two, there's this necessity of orderliness. Notice a word in verse number 19. He talks about singing and making melody. Now, the Greek word for that melody is really interesting. It has the idea of rubbing or plucking with fingers. It's akin to the idea of playing an instrument. Now, years ago, I was working at a camp, and I was with a fella, and this fella, he could play a piano. And again, I've told you, I'd be lucky if I could find middle C. But he could be really fast with his fingers, really fast. So I sat down one day, and he's sitting next to me, and he's playing this piece. I don't know what it was. And I just happened. Like, you ever read where they can teach a chimpanzee to type hello? That's the case. That's when I say I happened. I just happened. Probably the same chance happened. That I hit two or three notes at the same time that he was hitting that fit well musically with whatever he was doing. And he stopped and looked at me and he said, "Can you do that again?" 10 out of 10 times, I couldn't do it again. So he said, "I'll tell you what, I'll get to playing, and when I nod my head at you, you do whatever you did." And so I nodded, and I hit. He said, "That wasn't it. These are the three you hit. Hit these three when I nod my head. Only when I, you know." And I was so happy. He'd get to playing, and he'd nod. And, you know, it's like we're playing together. Well, pretty soon the gig was up. Everybody knew that I didn't know what I was doing. I just started randomly hitting keys. And we were just laughing and carrying on. I'm saying this for a point. There was no order to what I was doing. There was no structure. Music is not music simply because someone is playing an instrument. You don't need me to give you an illustration. But I could. Let me open a book. Let me sit behind the piano. And let me strike that key for a couple of times. And I promise you, you'll look and say, "Pastor, stop making noise." Godly music always has structured order. Notice the third thing. I want you to look also in verse number 19. This phrase, making this melody in your heart, it has genuineness. It has genuineness. What do you mean? It's from the heart. I mentioned earlier, I would rather have, well, ideally, I'd rather have a very talented, spirit-yielded person sing praises to God in my ear, or for my ears. That's what I'd rather have. But if I cannot have that, I would prefer to have a spirit-yielded person attempt to sing. More so than to have a talented person that was not spirit-filled sing. That's the order I'm telling you of. Why? Because that spirit-yielded person, that song comes from the heart. To prove this point, I mentioned a fellow from the 1950s. You know, in his later life, now people talk about his conversion and stuff, but in his later life, he made a lot of Christian music. Many an artist today sings Christian, quote-unquote, music. It has no real binding effect. It's not spirit-led. It's not spirit-filled. It's dollar bill-filled. That's why it's present. There's some cautions. Now, at the top of that list, spirit yielded. Notice the second thing that we'll find in these passages about music, particularly worship music. There's to be a continuous nature. Notice the active participles that are present. Active means it's always going. Do you see it? Verse number 19, the first word, what is it? Speaking. Notice after the psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, there's another one ending in ing. What is it? Singing. And there's another one, and making. These are active participles. They continue doing. So what I could say is, the godly, spirit-yielded music that I'm going to sing ought to be something that is constant. That word speaking is interesting. I would draw your mind to it for a picture. Laleo is the Greek word. It has the idea of speech, and by emphasis, it's almost like the noise a child would make when they go la, 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 la. Speaking to yourself. Oh, sometimes talent gets the best of us in the idea of worship. We get called on to having arrangements. I'm not preaching against arrangements. We get caught up in the complexity of things my friend, the worship God would have. Yes, He would have talent coupled preeminently with spirit control in our life. But my friend, He is greatly pleased with the child of God that bows the knee in humble submission to His Spirit and just la 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 might be the only thing they can sing. It ought to be continuous. These active participles denote a continuous action. I would note, if you look down in verse number 20, you find it again, giving of thanks. You look down in verse number 20, what is it? Submitting yourself. Do you see how they all end in ing? That is not an accident. It is continual. When should I not sing? I ought to sing all the time. Now, I know there's some of us that everyone agrees. We ought to quantify our singing only to the shower. I get that the point. But you see, godly music is of such great importance to the Almighty God. And there are a number of reasons we'll look at in just a moment when we look at the content. But one of the great reasons is it is the way to calm our mind and heart at the wondrous deeds and attributes of the Almighty God. That's why you sing. You don't sing so you can... I'm talking about spiritual, godly singing here. It's not meant, the indicativeness of it is not meant so that we have fun. It's not meant to be a physical exercise. Godly music is not meant to be something that someone can look and see how great an expert we are at a certain portion of music. Godly music's requirements to be spirit yielded and orderly, etc., and they are to be continuous in nature. Why? Because they remind us of who God is, and we need to be reminded often of who God is. They remind us of the promises of God, and we need often to be reminded of the promises of God. They remind us of our emotions, and they remind us of our will, if you will. Need to be in submission with the truths of the Word of God. That's why they need to be continuous, because we always need these things. And God has ordained that music, particularly godly music, played this important role in our life. All right, well, what is the content? Look in verse number 19, three of them. Psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. This is what he ordered in the church at Ephesus. If you were to go to the church of Ephesus at this day and hour, if it was still in existence, you would walk into this assembly and you would say, well, what kind of singing do you have? They knew nothing of contemporary music. They knew nothing of old-fashioned music. They only knew psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. And I'll throw a fourth one in there. And various degrees of talented people being submissive to the Spirit of God, singing them. What do you mean? Well, the Ephesian church was not the temple of God. It wasn't Solomon's place. Solomon's place, he had 4,000 singers. Can you imagine applying for that job position? Imagine going to Solomon's temple and Solomon's put this prince in charge. All right, now you're going to get me 4,000 singers. How would you vet that? Bring them all up. Surely they would all, we'd all be in agreement. They all had to be able to find middle C. I'm disqualified. They might would talk about the range of octaves they could hit. Some of us have great range, but octaves isn't our thing. There's probably a lot of people that applied that didn't make it. What Solomon was striving for was a level of perfection that a civil society can bring. You know, there are civil groups that folks are part of today. And in order to sing, you can't just sing because you want to, right? You got to have a level of expertise. Some of our musicians that play on Sundays that play in orchestra. There's a lot of orchestra groups, clubs that you can be part of, but it is a prerequisite that you be able to play a certain level. You know, the church at Ephesus, they may have not had people with that level of cunning and skill. What was the requirement? Sing the right content with the right heart. And make full use of any advantage you can in life. That last part's important. That's why at our church on Thursday nights for the last many years, We have a young class, and in one of that class, they go over is music. Why? It's giving an opportunity to some children of godly parents, maybe an opportunity the parents themselves did not have in life. I've had my little children come home, and I won't dare try to, but they'll tell me music, use musical phrase, Dad, do you know what this musical phrase is? No, I didn't. Didn't have that opportunity. Where'd they learn that? Why did they learn it? They learned it for an opportunity to worship God with the talent that He might have given them. And that talent being somewhat discovered and being certainly advanced by their own practice. You walk into the church of Ephesus, you say, what kind of music? Get contemporary music? You got old-fashioned, they would say, no, we got Paulinian church music. We've got psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. And spirit-yielded people that attempt in various fashions to sing it to the best of their ability. All right, what is a psalm, hymn, and spiritual song? Well, the word psalm, you probably need a better translation of the Bible here for this Greek. It is the Greek word psalm. That's what it is. And what you think it is what it really is. He's referencing the Old Testament book that falls before Proverbs and after Job, the Psalms. Psalms. In fact, we would say that Old Testament psalms put to music. Early churches used what was referred to as psalters. On your way out, right under the offering box, if you want one, there's about a half dozen psalters out there. It was our church gift to some of our families a couple years ago. But essentially, and by the way, I guess about a month ago, I sat in the living room with someone and they said, I want to show you something. And they pulled out a book about that big and about that thick. And I was surprised. I looked at it, I knew exactly what it was. But then I opened it and began to read the insert. It was from Lancaster County. 1840-something, I think is what it was. To my surprise, it was a Baptist Psalter. And if you leaf through it, there was no musical scores whatsoever in the book. All it was Old Testament passages, primarily the Psalms, and above it, it would give indications like C.M. or L.M. And what that stood for is common meter or long meter. And then a tune would be picked, and there was a series of tunes from common meter or long meter, and you had to know the tunes. And by the way, where did you learn the tunes? You came to church and you heard other people sing, and that's how you learned the tunes. I'll just say it. There was a day that the only people that sang Christian music were Christians that went to church. And if you came to church and you couldn't sing Christian music, then it was a tell-all that you were out of element. And no time did somebody come into church that didn't know Christian music was ever asked to sing just because they had a talented ability to sing. It was all lynched together. Why? They recognized the importance of being spiritually yielded to the singing of the Word of God. Now, a child of God was never spiritually yielded if a child of God wasn't ordering their life in a spiritual way. That's where it went. And so the song leader would get up and he'd pick a tune. He might say, Old 100th. That's in your hymnal. And everybody knew what that tune was. And you read the words and you sang the song and you closed your little psalter. And you'd take that psalter in your Bible. And you would read your Bible and you'd be in the middle of a field and you'd pull out your old psalter. It was tiny so you could carry it with you. And you'd open that up and you'd find the song you wanted to sing. And there's your common meter and you'd think of the tune, whichever one it was. You'd sing it. And that's all they had for hundreds of years. That's what he's talking about, psalms. It's the expression of scriptures. I would say that's what psalms are today. It is the singing of the scriptures put to godly music in the assembly. He uses another one here. It's hymns. This is a song of praise. This is a song of praise of what he has done. Early in the churches, particularly in Colossians chapter 1, that was a song that I might know him, he speaks of in Colossians chapter 1. The wisdom of God and things of this nature. I think of a hymn today would be like, a mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Spiritual songs. These were songs of testimony. They were general expressions of faith. The word songs is where we get the word an ode. But spiritual tells me it's just not some kind of ode. It is a non-carnal ode. Odes are not new to humanity. We mentioned Jubal, who handled the harp and organ. A spiritual song today would be one like, "No one cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind as He." And then finally, there's the calling. My time's gone. I'll give you this last phrase. He says, "To the Lord." Because this music is to be to the Lord, there are many responsibilities placed upon the singer. They need to be distinct. They need to be focused on the things of God. They need to be holy. The music needs to be accurate, theologically sound. They need to be separated unto the Lord. All of this is true in music. Why? Because it's how we worship God. And a spiritual yielded person is someone that enjoys and embraces spiritual worship to God in song. Music should not simply be left to an individual's preference or taste. Music is part of a believer's worship to God, both privately and corporately. And if God is going to be pleased with our music, it must meet His standard of responsibility. If our music does not measure up, let us remember the four R's: repent, remove, replace, and resist. Speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart unto the Lord. How's your singing? How's your singing? Oh yes, we're quick to tell how our troubles are going. We're quick to confound how much we dislike. When was the last time the joy of God abode in our heart? Let's stand to our feet. Father,
thank you for listening. If you'd like to contact us, please write us at P.O. Box 126-541, Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, 17112. And visit our website at www.svbcpa.org. Until next time.